There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way is the walls are closing in. When I look at this place between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, and another died for me. There is another in the fire. All my dead left for dead beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world.
Hey church, good morning, KTF Church on YouTube. Very excited to be with you today. We're going to talk about marriage, and I believe it's going to be a blessing to you. There are so many great things to learn about husbands and wives and how they can work together, how they can make their home better, how they can make their lives better. I believe we serve a God of joy, and I believe we serve a God of peace. He wants us to all get along with one another, and I believe that God is going to give us a word today. So Can we just pray together? Heavenly Father, we just thank you for the husbands and the wives and the moms and the dads and the grandparents. And Father, we thank you that you designed the home, that you created the home for a place of love and learning and for companionship and for enjoyment of each other's company. And God, I just pray that this broadcast would bring peace into people's homes, bring clarity into people's homes. God, we thank you for the teachings in your word that can help us to be better than we have ever been before. So, amen. God bless you. We're going to talk about some things this morning. We're going to open our Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 3. If you're new to Christianity and don't know anything about Christianity, or you've heard some controversial things about Christianity, I hope to clear some things up for us all today. Amen. So 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 1 and 2. And now let me speak to the wives. Be devoted to your own husbands, so that even if some of them do not obey the word of God, your kind conduct may win them over without you saying a thing. For when they observe your pure, godly life before God, it will impact them deeply. Now, this is a beautiful passage of scripture, but it's so easy to take it out of context. I have to read the Bible as a whole. I don't read one passage of scripture and say that's what it means for the whole Bible. No, all the pieces of a particular topic, whether it's marriage, whether it's family, whether it's how to act, how to, the place of money, your job, politics, whatever it is, whatever the order is, whatever the principle is, we have to take from the whole Bible. We can't just take one passage of scripture. So I want to talk a little bit about submission. It's been a misused word in Christian circles, and I would like to just get some of this down. It's so important that we understand that God is a God of order, and so God is not looking to put limitations on women, as some have taught. I've been in the ministry, it's going to be 40 years this year, and we've had women preachers, women elders, women who have helped run the church, women that have been on my board. And we read certain passages of scripture where Paul talked about women being silent in the church and not to teach a man. He was talking to one particular church with boisterous women that were out of order, women that had just gotten saved. They didn't understand the decorum of the church or being respectful to their husbands. They came out of paganism. Come on. And even that word there, women, it has a very deep connotation of wife or spouse. So he was trying to bring order to the home. It wasn't bringing limitation to women in any way, shape, or form. I also want to talk a little bit about the Proverbs woman. So the Proverbs woman is an amazing woman. If you read it, she's in business. She's able to have a business. The thing is, it's about priority. So I'm a father and I'm a husband, but I always have to prioritize the things that I do outside the home that it benefits my home. My priority is my wife. My priority is my children. My priority is to make sure that my home is functioning according to the order and the will of God. And so it's so very, very important that the wife's role is her first and primary thing is the home. It says a wise woman builds her house, an unwise woman tears it down. So unless we're building our relationships and doing the right thing, if we come out of the order of God, our home is going to fall apart. I've been just reading more and more about scandals that we haven't heard of, guys that we thought had good marriages. And even with men, if you spend 80 hours a week, of course your secretary is going to look attractive. Come on, because we've ignored our wives. We spent no time with them. We didn't have a priority. We didn't balance our work life with our home life. And so it's very, very important. I think the word of God is practical. I'm going to be a little practical today. So the first thing I want to tackle is I want to tackle the word submission. Yes, the Bible said, wives, submit yourself to your husbands. But you have to understand something. There are lots of things that we submit to. We submit to the government. We submit to the laws of the Constitution. We submit to a police officer when he pulls you over. I mean, nobody likes getting a ticket or having your car looked at, you know. But, you know, we have to submit to the rules and the government of a country. The pastor is submitted to God, but he has to run the church. He has to rule the church. Somebody has to be in authority. The church needs a direction. The church needs a purpose. The church needs to flow in the will of God. That pastor has to be on his face. His first priority is to love and feed and protect those sheep. But he's in authority. He's the one that God has given to do that. That doesn't mean he abuses his authority. And I believe so much of Christian teaching about marriage is about wives, and with good reason, to you know, to look at that and say, well, there's all these imperfect men, and how can I submit to somebody? Well, I'm submitted as a husband to Jesus Christ. I am under Jesus Christ. You know, in the Bible, it says something amazing. It says that Adam was made first, and the woman was made for Adam. Right away, we get this picture of someone not being equal, or someone having a lesser or greater value. No, it's a picture of Christ. Christ is supreme. Christ is the creator of the universe. In a sense, all the people who belong to Christ, the Bible calls them like a bride. Eventually, to the Father, they are a children. These are descriptions for human beings to grasp concepts. So if I'm a husband and a man, and the Bible said that Adam was first. Adam is a picture of Jesus Christ. He came first, and the church was made for him. So the Bible said that the woman was made for man. It doesn't mean that Jesus doesn't respect the church, or the husband doesn't respect the wife. Jesus desired the church. Jesus desired a bride. The man was alone. The man could not have family. And so, you know, they became one. They became partners. The Bible said, eventually it says, and he created them Adam. So though one has an order first, it doesn't mean that one is of a lesser value. It is not. Peter will tell us later on, as we read this, that if the husband is not careful and he mistreats his wife, that his prayers will be hindered, that God won't listen to a man that's a bully or unkind to his wife. You also have to remember too, the husband's job was to go out into the world so his wife could stay home and raise the children, to have a priority. It did not mean that she couldn't have other gifts and talents that were outside the home. But the priority for the husband, as well as for the wife, is to make sure your home is in order first. And when the husband leaves, we have children that are being raised by strangers rather than a mom and dad who can put godly values in them. I understand economic principles and that things are different. There's so much I could talk to about that. You know, we go to the mall on a Sunday. We have sports on a Sunday. We do so many things on a Sunday. We relax on a Sunday. We have football on a Sunday. But the Sunday was kind of meant for a Sabbath, and that God would bless the other 6 days as we spend time with our family and with God. You know, today, you know, where we have to sometimes trust God for our finances. And so, you know, there's just an order to things. And yes, that order is broken down, and it gets back to faith, trusting God, that God knows what he's doing, that when he put these principles, and they are principles in the Word of God, that our families would be happy and healthy and whole. So we're all in submission to someone. Pastors, husbands, they're in submission to God. They cannot abuse their authority. First of all, our first job as a husband is to love our wives so that they feel secure, protected, and provided for. Secure, protected, and provided for. Secure, protected, and provided for. If you fail to do that, of course a wife would not submit to you, because you're failing to do your job. So whether a husband, a wife, child, or pastor, or a member of a church, we're all submitted to someone. Don't be afraid of the word submission. We have to be submitted to something. That's how we learn. That's how we grow. That's how we keep the order. It is a role, a job description, something we do. A wife is a job description. A husband is a job description. But it's also part of the natural order of being human beings. So, you know, there's a heavenly order, you know. So don't be afraid of the word submission. The foundation of the word submission is the word love. We can only submit to people that we trust and people that love us. I submitted my life to Jesus Christ 30 some odd years ago because I believed he loved me and I trusted him that he was going to provide, protect, and care for me. So important. Submission is a place of trust and of peace. It's about caring one for another. So don't get flipped out over the word submission. It's just crazy to think that we're not submitted to all to one another. So anyway, so there's another question that Apostle Peter tackles here, and it is to try to marry someone who is a disciple of Jesus Christ. Marry someone who serves Christ so we don't have to struggle to compromise in our walk with God. I know many godly wives whose husbands participate in things that are unbiblical, that are impure, that are unholy, that sexual conduct that's wrong, conversations that are wrong, language that is wrong. I can just tell you so many things. It is much easier when we're both on the same moral plane, when we both are trying to serve God, when we both understand the concepts of the Bible, of submission and of love and of truth and of walking as good people in the order of God. So Paul in several of his letters advises Christians, you know, it is so much better to marry in your faith. There are many women that have been taken out of the faith because their husbands, they didn't want to lose their husband. You never want to be in a position between having to choose between your husband or God. That's a terrible place to be put in, to choose between your faith and your marriage. That's an awful place. So the admonition is always to have to try to marry someone who's pursuing Christ. The reason for that is they will treat you right. The Bible teaches a husband to treat his wife. I know this particular letter, Paul is talking to women, but in Ephesians, it's really talking about both. So if you don't want to struggle in your walk with God, marry someone that is a committed follower of Jesus Christ. You know, I mean, so many people call them Christians, but they never darken the door of a church. You know, they never submit to the will of God to come to church, to learn, to grow, to be accountable. I don't know what to say. I can't judge their Christianity, but I can judge their disobedience. And they're going to have to choose, you know, whether or not they can stand before God, having lived in continual disobedience. So if you're married to someone that's not a Christian, maybe you got married before you were Christian, or it happened, you know, you made that mistake, okay? Live your faith for yourself, first and foremost, okay? Because if you do, you will be a godly example. You know, we can't kind of put on a show before our husband, before our children. Our faith has to be genuine. I love that word. Your faith has to be genuine. It's not something we play act. It's not something we act out. So make sure that you yourself are growing in Christ, that you yourself have the correct spirit on you. Peter here is saying that you can win him by your conduct. I don't think any man has ever been nagged into the kingdom of God. It's going, or any woman, it's going to take prayer. It's going to take godly behavior. And I believe the order of the home, where the wife is really taking care of the husband and the children, it's a priority. I think it's going to endear that husband to that wife, and vice versa. A husband that's doing the right thing, it will endear, hopefully, that wife to that man. So it's Very beautiful. Wives, love your husbands faithfully. Be faithful. Be faithful to your marriage vows. Be faithful. One man, one woman. Be faithful. That's the order of God. One man, one woman. Love each other. Love your husbands deeply. Minister to their needs. I'm going to talk about that. There must be no struggle for leadership. The husband, listen, desperately needs the prayers and godliness of his wife as they co-lead their family together. Come on. My wife and I has always prayed together. Whenever there was a crisis or a situation or a circumstance, she's always prayed together. She has prayed for me, laid her hands on me when I was sick or worn out or burnt out or tired. She's prayed that my faith wouldn't fail. I mean, this is what a good wife does. She loves her husband faithfully, deeply. The godliness of my wife has strengthened me and helped me. How she raises my children has helped me to have confidence that God's purposes and plans for my life and for my wife and for my children are in a forward motion, where we're not going backwards. We know what we're doing because the Word of God has given us guidance. So many people don't have guidance. When you don't have guidance, you need a guidance counselor. So many people go into marriage counselors, and it's okay. I like marriage counselors. I'd rather go and have you talk it out than break up. But have a Christian one that understands the principles of God. So there must be no struggle for leadership. The husband needs. Many times my wife has even prayed for me for wisdom. I have needed wisdom. There are many times in my life I have needed wisdom. She said, you're leading our family where, you know, where our provision might be, where our job is, where we have to go, what direction we have to go in. I'm going to pray for you that God will speak to you and help you to make the right decisions. Can't have split leadership. Doesn't work. Husband and wives are functions and order needed for the home. So unfortunately, the husband has to leave the home. But the wife is the stability, the foundation. She makes the home beautiful. She takes care of the home. By the word home, I mean the place that you live in. She keeps the house clean, food on the table. You know, she's good with the husband's salary, with the budget, with so many things. I mean, wow, no matter how great the CEO is of a company, he needs really great people in that organization to run that country. While he's out making the deals or doing what he has to do, you know, he's got people in-house who are taking care of things. Wife, mom, you are so valuable. You are valuable to the husband. You are valuable to the home. You're valuable to God. I mean, I would advise everyone to read the Proverbs woman. I know plenty of entrepreneurial women who are fantastic mothers, fantastic wives. I have daughter-in-laws that work outside the home, but their first priority is their husbands and their children. They have not abandoned their duties for their careers. That's a tremendous thing. We all have to strike a balance. Let's face it, whether you're a husband or whether you're a wife. So there's a function that's needed for the children to be raised properly, to be raised in a godly manner. So just a little something for the men here. Godly man leads his family into the things of God and the will of God through the partnership of marriage. So husbands, you know, Paul said to his church members, follow me as I follow the Lord. Notice he didn't say just follow me. No, he says, as I follow the Lord, your wife will follow you as you follow the Lord. Guess what? You're reading the same book. You're reading the same principles. You're reading the same truths. And she'll see if you're following the Lord. If you want somebody to follow you, make sure you're following the Lord. Make sure you have the attitude that Christ had for his church, that he gave his life for her. So men, we're surrendering our life to our wives and to our children. We're laying our lives down that they would have a good life, a godly life, a life where they're enjoying the presence of God and the principles of God. That home will be filled with joy, filled with peace. So that husband will be held accountable for the family he was entrusted with. So wives, help him. He's carrying a big load. And husbands, help your wives. It's so important. There's been many times where I came home from work after a long day and I didn't say, okay, have you taken care of the home? No, sometimes I had to pitch in. They did a study, I'm not sure how many years ago, but they had a wife, she was a cook, she was a housekeeper, she was a nanny. They put it all up. It was like $250,000 a year you'd have to pay the woman. So, you know, honor the woman, honor the woman, honor that woman that is your wife, that you're committed to, you've covenanted to, and that you love. It's beautiful. It is a marriage, if it's done right, will become a partnership. It has to also remember this. Your marriage will never last if it's not a friendship. I mean, listen, I thank God that God gave us that intimacy component, that sex component, let's be honest, but you can't build your house on one thing. You cannot build your relationship on one thing. That can be so easily moved. You start having children, you start getting busy, you start getting things. It's not that the romance ever goes away, it's that priorities change. And guess what? Sometimes it's all the more sweeter because you've been apart. It's really a blessing to make sure you have a friendship with your wife, that she should pretty much be your best friend. And that's a good way to live. So you'll be accountable to your family, men. And so wives, help him to walk in that accountability. And you'll receive together God's godly reward for living a good life. Never forget this. Peter said this, you're both heirs of salvation. In the eyes of God, you're sexless. In the sense of that you're both heirs of salvation. There's not going to be sexist in heaven, you know. So as far as God is concerned, you're both spirits of equal rank, of equal purpose, of equal quality, and to be loved equally. Your function is just different right here on earth. Thank God. Vive la function. So never forget, you're both heirs. Love gives, love receives. It never takes. So both husband and wives must give themselves to one another in every area of their lives. We must make sure we're meeting each other's needs in every way. I'm not going to go into detail, but in duties around the house, in making sure that you have a friendship, in going to church, and in doing everything. It is a partnership. Don't get into a place where you have to take something from a wife or take something from a husband because the other person is not giving. It's got to be a 50-50 proposition. And sometimes it's not going to be 50-50. Sometimes it may be 80-20, and you got to suck it up and get through that season. Because I remember when we had babies, oh my God, it was 80-20. I would work and then I'd come home and help with the kids. It was really hard. I would rather be out there with the lions and tigers and bears than home with the kids. I'm only kidding. Anyway, so love gives, it never takes. So both husband and wife give themselves to one another. I want to close with this. Marriage is illustration, sanctification, and procreation. I want to talk about those two things quick. Marriage is an illustration of Christ and the church. They have given themselves completely to one another, both sacrificially and by the deepest love and care and respect for one another. Jesus loved his church so much that he gave his life for it. A husband loves his wife so much that he gives his life. He spends himself, his hours, his days, his toil, whatever it is, to provide and to protect for his family. The same thing with a wife. Marriage is a beautiful illustration of Christ and the church. Christ has loved us and we know it. Now we as the church have to make sure that we're almost like the wives, because Christ is the head of the church. We have to love him as much as he loved us. That's true Christianity. It's not law keeping. It's not legalism. It's loving God enough to honor him, to respect him, to keep his commands, to obey his laws that are only there to make us happy and healthy and whole. I love those words. It's a picture of sanctification. Husbands, have your own wives. We are not to have our sexual needs met outside of marriage. So we give ourselves to one another. It's a way of being sanctified. Paul said it's better to marry than to burn. People have the gift of marriage. People will have sexual needs. Now make sure those sexual needs don't overarch love, because when they do, your wife is not a prostitute. A husband is not a prostitute. We don't prostitute ourselves. We're in that committed relationship. In the deepest times of worship, I have felt an ecstasy. I have felt a love, an intimacy, a oneness with God. I really have felt as though I was joined heart to heart and mind to mind and soul to soul with God. I want you to know that the union of a husband and wife is meant to be an ecstasy, a coming together, a becoming one that transcends the physical. And it's so powerful to have that oneness of union, where it's not just bodies that are meeting, but hearts and minds and souls in an ecstasy of the deepest love. Come on, that's what it's about. So it's also for sanctification. Also, marriage is for procreation. We are the only creature on the face of the earth that gets to have little children or creatures that are made in the image and likeness of God. Procreation is serious business. That's why we are to raise our children up in the admonition of the Lord, train them up in the way they should go, and they should not depart from it. Teach our children the word of God. Send them to Sunday school. Live as godly examples. Play Christian music in the home. Teach them to worship the God that's good. They will know God's promises. They will be provided for, cared for. God will take care of them. They'll have a supernatural relationship with God that will benefit their whole lives. It'll keep them from trouble, heartache, consequences. Come on. It's a good thing to raise your children in the admonition of the Lord. We're raising image bearers. Oh my God. To have a child outside of marriage, it's cruel to the child. And yes, we all fail and we all make mistakes. I get it. And we all have sexual needs, but the purpose of marriage was, we're going to make image bearers. We're making children who are to continue in the image and likeness of God. It is a serious thing to have a child. It is not something that we should take lightly. That's why marriage must be a committed thing. A husband and wife must love one another. We never want to abandon the children because we cannot get along, or our problems are so great that our children are ignored. Come on. We are in the process of procreation. That's why God said in the beginning that God made the male and female for the purpose of image bearing, procreation. It's how God designed us. And it's very, very beautiful. So marriage is an illustration, a sanctification, and a procreation. Sex inside of marriage keeps us holy. That's what it's for. Keeps us sanctified. The marriage bed is undefiled. It's a place of procreation where we're bringing image bearers. And that's a place of illustration where we give and give and love and surrender our lives for the priority, for the benefit of our family, as Christ left heaven for the benefit of his church, his bride. I hope you enjoyed this. I hope it clarified some things. May I pray with you? I'd like to pray. If you are a disciple of Christ, I still want to pray this with you. If you have not chosen to be a disciple of Christ and follow him with all your heart, please pray this with me. Say, Jesus, I want to surrender my life to you. And whatever is between you and I, whatever sins I've committed, I receive what you did on the cross for me. I ask you to forgive me of my sins. And Jesus, I believe you're calling me right now. And I enter into a deep covenant with you, a deep relationship with you, like a husband would with a wife. And Jesus, I surrender my life to you. I will follow you. I'll become your disciple. In Jesus' name, amen. It's so important to be committed to Christ. It's not enough just to know about church, but to say this prayer once and then live like you made no commitment, no covenant. Same thing as a marriage. You can't make a marriage vow and then live like you're single. And too many Christians are living like atheists. Love you guys, but I gotta tell it like it is. Love you so much. So let's start living for Jesus. Let's start being good disciples. God bless you. We'll talk to you soon.
place when the heart is under fire. Another way is the walls are closing in. When I look at this place between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire. Should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, another died for me. There is another in the fire. Death left a death beneath the waters. I'm no longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and its reckoning? Either way, I won't bow to the things of this world. 'Cause I know
where you'll be.